Good evening, everyone, and Ms. Macias and Dr. Gonzalez, we ready to go? Thank you. Wanting to remind everyone that we're live captioning our meeting, so please look in the chat window of our WebEx meeting where you will find a link. Please click on that link to open a webpage with the live captioning. Before I convene the meeting, I'd also like to acknowledge and wish Ms. Bittersmith a very happy birthday for tomorrow. Happy birthday.
For the record, we are counting backwards now.
And also would say welcome back to folks. It's been a while since we've been present with you, recognizing, of course, that for us, it seems like ages ago, and also acknowledging that you've probably all been very hard at work while the rest of us were able to take a little brief break. But if you had that opportunity as well, I hope it was a good one, renewed you, and gave you the energy for tackling another academic year. So delighted to see all of you and looking forward to a wonderful academic year as we move ahead. With that, I'd like to call to order the regular meeting of the Maricopa County Community College District Governing Board for August 22, 2023. For the record again, I'm going to call a roll of board members. And as usual, I'd like to start with you, Mr. Burnett, our student trustee.
Here.
Thank you. Ms. Bittersmith? Thank you. Ms. Butler?
Here.
Thank you. Ms. Davis?
Here.
Thank you. Dr. Narini?
Here.
Thank you. Ms. Smith?
Here.
Thank you. Dr. Thor?
Here.
With my presence, all board members are present and accounted for. We'll move to the Pledge of Allegiance, and I would like our birthday person, Ms. Bittersmith, to lead us in the pledge, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Ms. Bittersmith, and may you have a very happy birthday. We have some substitutions this evening. Dr. Deborah Hardy, Vice President of Academic Affairs, is present. Wait a minute, you're here. Okay, never mind. I'm crossing that off. I have a script. It said that you weren't here, Dr. Peterson. You must have. I had a substitution down for you, but I'm thinking, no, but you're here. Okay. Now this one I think is, yeah, if you know, you're now on record as being present. Dr. Wilson is present for Dr. Georgetta Kelly this evening. Thank you. We now have student life reports, and we'll start off with a report from Mesa. Welcome. Hello.
Hello. Okay. Is it working? Okay.
Yes, it is.
Awesome. All right. Let's wait for. There we go. Okay, so first we'll be doing introductions. So my name is Marty Severe, and I am this year's Maricopa Student District Senate representing Mesa Community College. And
okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Kiana Jacket. I am the Vice President of Communications this year.
Hi, everyone. My name is Florian Nguyen and Vice President of Operations.
Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you. So for our presentation today, we'll be sharing with you a presentation of both our student life updates and our shared vision of the future for Mesa Community College, as for the title there, for 2023 to 2024. And next slide, please. So for a brief overview for our report content and what we'll be talking about today is first our achievements, which we're able to reestablish a strong in-person student senate at our Mesa Community College, supporting student-led campus events, as well as passing amendment to ASMCC constitution. Next, we'll be going over our goals and events, the first being establishing a Red Mountain Student Council of Leaders, connecting to new students on day one, as well as upcoming events. And lastly, our student life updates, which will be leadership and multicultural programming, student-led Thursday events, and fields of interest for guided pathways. Next slide, please. And as we just did our introductions, these are 2023 to 2024 ASMCC e-board and district senator for Kiana and Florian and myself. We just introduced ourselves, but for Luisa Casillas, she's our vice president for ASMCC, and she unfortunately could not join us here today. Next slide, please. And here to do our ASMCC achievements will be Kiana Jacket.
Hello, everyone. So our achievements for reestablishing a strong and in-person student senate. So October 22nd is where we started. And also we had an attendance for clubs, student advocacy, and our campus as well, over 20 plus clubs as well, and passing multiple resolutions focused on our student inclusivity and support. For achievements as well is supporting students led campus events as the MCC powwow that we brought back. So we're happy about that. We also have a link for that powwow on our YouTube. So if you guys want to check that out. Also, we had a dodgeball tournament for a student versus faculty for our students to just, you know, help out there and get to know more about what Mesa Community College has to offer. And we also had movie nights and many more. And we have successfully passed the constitutional amendment as establishing the the president of Rand Mountain campus and establishing governing student organization for Rand Mountain campus and student leadership and advocacy for Rand Mountain students. Our goals and events for the future is establishing the Rand Mountain governing body and also connecting with new students. And our upcoming events are throughout the year is including the department's events like the MCC powwow, indicating to create an exclusive environment that connects with our campus students, ensuring a positive learning experience. And then our next slide. Thank you. And then it's going to be the students. Student Life Updates by Florian.
Hi. There are lots of updates from the student life. And first of all, it's the leadership and multicultural programming. We already have some events coming up like Thunderbird Dialogues and a lot of co-curricular events. And I think the most important one is we are trying to rename Thursday to Thursday instead of Thursday, which took quite a while to get the name going, but that's also one of the pretty important updates. And also for student run Thursday events, well, we try to build school spirits, connection, campus pride. And then for field of interest, we connect different clubs together and also students to the prospective clubs. And to further on the point of Thursday, we also have barbecue bash. And so those are the updates from student life. And next slide, please. And so, yeah, to keep update, we just follow Instagram, Facebook. We try TikTok, and then that grow back a bit. So, yeah, to keep in contact with us, that would be the best ways to Instagram or through us to student governments. Thank you.
Okay, it's been a month. I don't know how to press these buttons. Anyway, thank you for your presentation this evening. But before you go, can you tell us a little bit about your first day back at school? I guess that's an old way of saying that, but how do you feel being back or involved?
It's very odd.
Yes, I mean, we know the feeling.
Yeah, I know you guys are just like, we're just, you know, late. But overall, I think the energy is really good. We had a lot of, I noticed a lot of new students for this year, and we've had a lot of good engagement and interest in joining our student government for our cabinet positions. But overall, I think I feel pretty excited. I feel pretty good because, you know, new positions, and we're able to do these presentations for you guys and get to know you guys a little bit deeper, especially myself as a student senate. But overall, pretty good. There will be some adjustments, definitely, but nothing that we can't get used to. So
if you have one big thing I know you've shared your goals and given us updates and a lot of excitement for you, but what is it you would want to get out of this year for you and each of you?
So I'll go first. But I guess my main goal for this year would definitely be to focus more on student engagement, which is I feel is a very base goal. But due to COVID and due to a lot of students either being online or a lot of them just being very nervous, especially international students, they feel very, you know, nervous about engaging with student government or just engaging with other students in general. And I feel like my main goal would be to find how to become a bridge for them. Which is something that I've discussed with my student government as well as our advisor over there. His name's Ryan. Yeah, give me a little wave so they know. But my main goal is just to be the bridge for the students with each other, for their clubs and for their administration, and also be the bridge to you guys so we can actually be their voices and know what they need.
Wow, awesome. And the rest of you, each of you.
Hi. So I feel like my goal would probably be, you know, just being an advocate for the students. I have been here for like a year and this is my second semester going to Mesa. So it's been a pretty rough time because I'm a first generation student for my family. So everything's new to me and I really, really liked Senate. So I decided to just be the vice president of communications with these amazing people. And it's been such a crazy journey and I'm still learning. Everyone learns, but it's okay to be nervous. It's okay to be scared because we're all doing this together and that's what makes us a team. And I feel like just making sure that our students have the right resources as well, especially our online students. A bunch of them don't know the resources that we have and we're trying to be a more advocate for them to know those resources that they need.
Very admirable. Thank you.
Well, for me, I just want to connect different clubs together and let students know that joining clubs is part of the college experience, especially since we're transforming into a 4-year college student. And so that's something also I would like to await and see further news and let students know about that option so that the student engagement on campus starts going up and that students still feel the school pride and that they know that there are more weights at school other than just academic one. So those are my main goals. Thank you.
Thank you. I think I would speak on behalf of all the board that please chime in that you are the most important people to us as board members, and that is students. Yes, faculty, you're important. Yes, administrators, you're important. Yes, everybody else, Dr. Gonzalez. But I think that our shared interests and our shared message is that we want to be advocates and supporters of your interests. And so I think to one of us, we would applaud what you are interested in doing on behalf of your campuses and are really proud of how you can speak to your journeys and your interests. So with that, board members, let's give them another round of applause.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Dr. Robinson, great team out there. Yes, thank you.
Also, yes, little shout out for our president. I told her I would do one, so.
Thank you. Thank you. So now we'll move to the Faculty Executive Council report, Dr. Murcia.
Madam President, while my last name may end in a vowel, on my grandmother's side, I am a Murphy. So with respect to our shared Irish heritage,
okay,
and your request from last time,
yes,
I will address you personally tonight, not in our favorite French language, but rather in Gaelic. So without further ado, Uchtaran Ambera, membre du conseil d'administration, chancelier, CEC colleagues, honored students, and guests, Jambo. As we open a new academic year, I would like to offer a message of welcome to the new and a welcome back to the returning members of our Maricopa Community Colleges family. First, faculty leadership would like to extend a welcome to Dr. Tiffany Hernandez, the new president of GCC.
You beat me to the punch on that one.
Dr. Hernandez, dobro pozdravit. And a personal thank you to the hiring committee who was smart enough to hire another wildcat to hold the line in enemy territory.
Oh, sorry.
Faculty leadership also welcomes the new members of employee leadership, whom we look forward to working collaboratively with. Our adjunct faculty president, Ms. Kim Boge, and staff leadership co-president, Ms. April Roland. We look forward to working with you. Faculty leadership would like to welcome back over 1,400 faculty. Among this group are 56 new appointed faculty, those who have completed their five-year probationary period, and 95 new first-year probationary faculty. Most importantly, faculty are excited to welcome back approximately 74,000 students and to welcome a new and additional 4,000. Included in these ranks are approximately 4,100 students who are either new applicants or have moved into bachelor's degree programs. Without students, there would be no us. Last year, President Xi of China asked President Biden to describe America in one word. POTUS considered the question briefly, looked him square in the eye, and answered, possibilities. This exchange struck a chord with me because I thought the same thing could be said of Maricopa, possibilities. So let us welcome another academic year of possibilities, such as those that allowed the former Maricopa nursing student to get a job in the same ward at Phoenix Children's Hospital that had saved her child's life 6 years ago, or the anthropology student who achieved her AA and is now earning a PhD at, well, you guessed it, University of Arizona. Or that grandmother I told you about a few months ago who was still embarrassing her family with her mad social media skills. A student who I had in 2018 reached out to me last week to let me know that she had completed a master's degree in gastronomy with a focus on food anthropology. She said, as a community college professor, you often plant seeds you never get to see sprout. I hope today you feel empowered to keep planting them. Sometimes it takes time, but you get a bountiful harvest. And that was food for my soul right there, but also another way to illustrate the work we all do here. We are all gardeners in this Maricopa field one way or another. So let us welcome the possibilities that we, as part of various leadership and employee groups, embrace collaborative work, absent injurious nature, where the brilliance of ideas shines brighter than titles, and where the collective pursuit of excellence knows no hierarchy, where we all tend to this landscape of learning. I will close with a haiku. A fresh semester, hopeful hearts and eager minds, learning adventure.
Thank you. I never did learn how to speak Gaelic. Thank you. And I also made comment that you preceded my comments in welcoming Dr. Tiffany Hernandez to our team. So pleasure to make your acquaintance and welcome to Maricopa. And just for the record, I also want to acknowledge that this evening we have Ms. Jenna Schwartz, who's our interim president at Paradise Valley Community College. Nice to see you here this evening. Thank you. I'd like to move us on to the Faculty Association report. Ms. Boge, please.
Lisa is a hard act to follow. I'm afraid I won't have anything nearly as poetic to discuss tonight, but I will give you an update on what we've been working on. I'm new at this job. It's been my first couple of months this summer getting involved with my adjuncts as their president, rather as one of the reps. And so we have started fast and furious with summer committees and other work. One of our most important things is we have changed status from adjunct faculty association to adjunct faculty group. And so with that has come some other issues that we've had to deal with and solve, and some updates to our bylaws to put us in alignment with the district. And so we're working on that right now. Our bylaws committee is convening soon to address some of the changes that we need to talk about, as well as updating our policy manual. We've had a very productive summer, and we had two committees that developed products to serve our adjuncts. One of them was an onboarding committee that created a Canvas course to inform our new campus representatives of their roles and responsibilities and give them resources so that they can begin their job as liaisons more quickly and better informed. Our group created a great program that launched at the end of July so that they were able to put it into procedure before the semester started. And we've found it to be a quicker way to assimilate the adjunct reps into their jobs. Our website committee is the other summer committee that convened, and they have been revising the adjunct website or adjunct faculty website to reflect the changes from Adjunct Faculty Association to Adjunct Faculty Group, with resources for adjuncts, information on the tiers program, links to frequently needed documents, frequently asked questions, and other things that will help the adjuncts as a whole in the district. We haven't launched it yet because we're still working out a couple of the technical difficulties, but it's underway, and we've had a good group of people working on that this summer. We also developed a new logo that we'll be using for the group that reflects our new name and district identification. And in the last few weeks, our projects have been to promote and answer questions about the new tiers program and adjunct pay, as well as rolling out the new tiles in HCM that will allow adjuncts to upload and track their FPG hours for progress in the tiers and and help them get raises. In our ongoing internal committees, we're starting our new semester with bylaws and bylaws, media and communication, and a couple of other ones that are still coming together right now. And we've got people that are signing up and happy to be a part of it. We will be running elections over the next month, as we have 4 vacancies right now with the colleges. We have a vacancy at Phoenix College, South Mountain, Gateway, and Estrella. And so we're starting a new program with that and our new leadership team. We have actually changed the title of our vice presidents to reflect the new roles that they will be playing. Since we don't have money that we deal with anymore, we don't need a treasurer, but we do need somebody in charge of elections and order. So Michael Littlecrow is our VP of Elections and Order, and Christina Gerges is our VP of Administration, handling our meeting minutes and making sure that we're in alignment with other district things. And the three of us work really well together and have a great time planning our meetings and figuring out what else we can bring to the adjuncts as resources and help them get a little bit more ahead of the game so that they can talk to their constituents. Meanwhile, most of our reps are already talking to their constituents. I get updates from all the different reps of what they're doing on their campuses, and it's been wonderful to see how we all have different ways of doing the same thing. So onboarding committees at different, or rather onboarding sessions at different campuses, and how people are handling getting their new adjuncts ready to teach have been really fun to see. And we've also started contributing to the newsletter with an adjuncts corner, and so we're writing articles for that right now. We are currently getting ready to seat some people on some district committees, so right now we're sending out information to our reps to get them to see who is available schedule wise to be able to serve on those. And we are getting ready to start our next adjunct faculty handbook committee to address updates to the handbook. We have 2 past committees that'll be serving, myself and Christina Gerges, and 1 new member, Mary Zatazzolo, and we are currently getting our 4th person underway, but we're just trying to figure out again who can fit with the schedule. So as the AFG, we are glad for the opportunity to represent all of our adjuncts across the district and the work we do every day. And our adjunct population makes up a large part of the faculty at MCCCD, and we continue to encourage excellence and opportunity to serve the students in the district. Thank you for your time, and excited about the new year. Thank you. We're excited for you. Now we'll move to staff representation, Mr. Duvall and Ms. Colson. Hi.
Good evening, President Sullivan, Governing Board members, Chancellor Gonzalez, presidents, members of the CEC, and guests. I'm April Rowland, and next slide, please. I'm April Rowland, the new co-president for staff representation. I'm a non-exempt member. The other co-president is Calvin Duvall. He's our exempt co-president. Next slide, please. This month, we are featuring South Mountain Community College. Don Jensen Bobadilla is the senator for the campus. Daniel Labacata is the South Mountain exempt council staff. Mary Nunn, exempt council staff. Non-exempt Kelly McCarthy, David Gonzalez Limas, and Chris Gaelic.
So while you were away, we've been hard at work. The staff policy collaboration team, we had a retreat. We are looking forward to this year and bringing new policy changes, modifications in front of you so we can further the development of staff policy and make Maricopa a better place for staff. We also had several days of training and onboarding for our new staff reps, as there are many. This ended on the very last day with a very competitive brisket cook-off. We want to thank the judges. We were very lucky and were able to book 4 very prestigious, highly touted judges. So a special shout out and thank you to Dr. Robinson from Mesa, Dr. Smith, Rio Salado, Dr. Kelly, CHRO, and Ms. Shannon Maggi. They are experts in this field.
Gee, we weren't invited, but oh well.
And I can say this as champion of the cook-off that it was indeed an honor to have the judges there. So thank you. So myself, April, our new full-time VP, Patty, we have been going over to various colleges the last week, this week, helping out enrollment services, veteran centers, dual enrollment. This is peak and staff are hard at work and enrollment is up. Headcount, FTSE, attempted hours. We nearly have 1,500 students right now enrolled in bachelor programs. And we wanted to send a great thank you out to all the staff for your hard work and dedication. This is gonna be a great semester. There's a lot of buzz and our staff has been doing an outstanding job. So thank you. Next slide. We also want to thank the new leadership coming on board to chair our internal committees. This is part of the foundation of staff representation, the shared governance. Whether it's developing policy for staff, whether it's communication through newsletters, whether it's changing bylaws, making staff representation a better organization so it's more effective. We have a new conflict resolution committee coming out. And then, of course, elections and onboarding. So all these internal committees we have new leaders, and it really is a foundation for staff representation. So we want to welcome everyone on board there, too. Next slide. And finally, we want to thank and welcome our new staff senate. Half of these members are new, half of them are returning, but this is a senior council within Maricopa, and they have great responsibility. They dedicate more time than normal reps. They chair some committees. They're on councils, task force throughout the district, and they dedicate their time to make sure that Maricopa is an effective with everything that we do, from student success to internal operations. So thank you, staff senate, and welcome aboard. Next slide. And finally, we just want to say welcome to a new semester, fall 2023. We have a really good feeling about this semester. So welcome everyone who's new to the Maricopa family, and welcome all those who are returning. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Duvall. So, Ms. Rowland, I want to apologize to you for misstating your last name. Colson, where did that come from? Is that just, oh my goodness, all right, yay. Very nice, thank you. I now know why I made that error, but I appreciate the correction, thank you. So now we also have one emeritus award, and at this time, I'd like the college president, that would be you, Dr. Robinson, and Dr. Robert Hunter from Mesa Community College to be present at the podium. Exciting moment.
Yes. Hello there. Okay. So I'm just going to take a moment, okay?
1, 2, 3, go.
All right, so... President Marie Sullivan, governing board members, Chancellor Gonzalez, president, CEC members, students, faculty, staff, and of course our community. I would like to present to you Mr. Robert Smith, who was our faculty member for over 22 years. And so if I may, Dr. Gonzalez, I'd like to read the letter that's written on your behalf and then read your accomplishments, okay? So, dear Rob, congratulations on being awarded the Faculty Emeritus Distinction. On behalf of the Governing Board and the entire district, I wish to congratulate and honor you for your dedication and accomplishments in teaching and learning during your long and distinguished career as a faculty member with the Maricopa County Community College District. I thank you for your distinction, your distinguished service, and the legacy that you have left for our students. If I might take a moment, I'd like to read a list of his accomplishments. Maybe not every single thing. Not every single thing, but I would like to highlight when you dedicate this much time, you deserve your flowers and your moment. So you have directed concert bands, the community bands and chamber ensembles, administered and taught music education classes, served as guest conductor and clinician on hundreds of occasions, served multiple years of evening department chair, managed over 10 of our instrumental adjunct faculty, served an executive board for United Sound, a nonprofit that provides music inclusion for students with special needs, and created a student chapter for the United Sound at MCC Special Needs Inclusion Programs. This is now a core part of the training MCC provides for our music education students. Consistently recruited for the MCC Music Program while increasing the reputation of MCC by reaching out to hundreds of high schools, middle schools, and other band programs. Served as honor band director and clinician across the United States, Canada, Asia, and Europe. Served as a regional honor band director over 15 times for 7 regions while representing and recruiting for MCC. Presented at the Midwest Band Orchestra Clinic in Chicago as a representative of Mesa Community College. Was also the director of the Mesa Summer Music Camps, including over 400 students, faculty, staff per season. Served as the building co-chair for MCC from 2008 to 2014, taught humanities, developed trained adjunct faculty with online, recruited jazz and popular music. The list goes on and on, it goes on and on and on, but we're going to stop right there. And I present to you our emeritus faculty member, Mr. Robert Smith.
Hunter. Thank you so much. So appreciate you.
Thank you so much. This is your moment.
Thank you so much. I can't even begin to tell you what a tremendous career, almost 3 decades, most of it being at MCC, has been. And it's because of the support that we have in this district, especially our governing board, our faculty, our staff, the foundations that we've worked with for so many years together to build things, and of course, all the students and the colleagues. You mentioned earlier, President Sullivan, students are core, and they sure have been for all of us. And it shows. We have a beehive at Mesa Community College, of activity, of engagement, of love, and it's represented, of course, the great one here, Dr. Robinson. Like, she amps us up there. She makes sure that everything is flowing the way it should be, and all of us just love to strive for that enjoyment, that excitement, and love for teaching and learning. And it's been just an incredible honor. And I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart. I hope to continue and give back as much as I possibly can for the rest of my life. And thank you so much.
Thank you. Dr. Hunter, do you have a special person with you here this evening?
I do. Very, very special. This is my wife, Michelle. And please say hello to Michelle.
Awesome.
And I have 2 children that are 17 and 13 that are in the Gilbert School District playing saxophone and trumpet.
Ooh, cool.
And I know many of you are musicians and arts advocates in here. And so just one more thank you for the profound impact that the arts have had on all of our students and how much you support them. It does not go unnoticed. We appreciate it so much. Thank you.
You're welcome. Congratulations. Well, Dr. Gonzalez, you have a hard act to follow with all of those reports, but it's your turn.
Thank you, President Sullivan, for pointing that out.
Yeah, welcome back.
Welcome back. President Sullivan, members of the board, and our CEC and guests that are with us this evening, let me just say welcome back to the fall semester, a new academic year. I think it's going to be a very exciting year. You're going to hear about a strategic plan and what KPIs may look like for that, I believe, I think. Maybe not the way Kathy's looking at me. Anyhow, this is something that we've been putting an enormous amount of time and effort and energy into, and it's going to be a guiding document for us for the next few years. The exciting part about it is that, you know, it's got a 3-year life term, and likely in another year to year and a half, we're going to start that process again in preparation for the next 3 years. So this is something that's going to continue in the way that Maricopa operates. As was mentioned by Calvin, our enrollments are up across the system. Headcount is up over 5%. This was reported as of the week before the semester started. So this Friday, we'll get numbers of where we actually were beginning this week. And FTSE is up approximately 3.6% across the system. This is the first time in a long time that, at least in headcount, every single college is up in headcount. So again, as Calvin said, I want to take this moment to appreciate the faculty and the staff that are on the front lines of recruiting our students, and then to everyone else, because I say that we all play a role in recruitment and retention of our students. And I know each and every one of you have had a conversation with someone you know about, did you know at Maricopa we have a program? And then you fill in the blank, right? So that's certainly you doing your role in helping recruit more students to Maricopa. Over the next couple of days, Mrs. Sullivan and I will be involved in a retreat for AC4 and the trustees portion of that organization up in Flagstaff. I had an opportunity to talk to CEC today about the importance of that organization and Maricopa's presence on that group in ensuring that we play a major role in the direction of what our community colleges are doing across the state of Arizona. And I also shared with you, and I'm sharing with the board for the first time, with the exception of having a conversation with Mrs. Sullivan, that Maricopa was invited to the White House to talk about advanced manufacturing with, I have to read this, the National Economic Council and Domestic Policy Council to discuss workforce development and partnerships with unions. So I'll be able to represent Maricopa and talk about our amazing programs next Monday on behalf of Maricopa. So I think that that's a great honor for Maricopa to be on that kind of a map, that we are being invited by the White House to come and speak to some of the amazing things that we've been able to do. So people are paying attention to Maricopa in some really good ways across the country right now. So I just wanted to share that.
May I throw in an anecdote on that one? So he calls and tells me that he's been invited, but not sure he should go. Because, you know, there's so many commitments here. This is when the board president says to him, Dr. Gonzalez, it's the White House. Dr. Gonzalez, you're going. Though I did appreciate your commitment to the system and staying and leading. But we want you to lead there, too. So, right? So we're all saying go. We're glad you're going.
I am going.
Yeah.
How's that? On a local level, I haven't had an opportunity today, but if you've had an opportunity to watch the news, we have some local celebrities here, both from South Mountain and from Rio. Rio was on News Channel 3 this morning to talk about nano manufacturing, and my joke was that it was a small segment. And microelectronics, it's a program that's designed for veterans, and after 12 weeks our veterans can interview for a job and likely land one. And I think I heard you say earn somewhere between $50,000 and $80,000 a year starting. That's just an amazing program, and it doesn't cost the veterans anything to participate. And over at South Mountain, news or Fox 10 was there to highlight our construction trades institute. And so I'm sure that you guys showed off some really amazing things that you're doing there. So again, these are just really small examples of the wonderful things that our colleges are involved in. Our faculty and staff are on the cutting edge of developing these programs, and people are paying attention to what we're doing. So I appreciate you. And if anyone out there in the news world is listening, we appreciate that sort of attention that you're affording us, and we're happy to continue to showcase that for you. Now, for the next portion of my update, I'm going to invite up some folks to talk about the strategic planning process and where we are. So Would Dr. Hernandez and Dr. Newton and Dr. Danielle please come up? These folks are tri-chairs of the strategic planning steering committee that they're going to discuss.
Good evening, President Sullivan, members of the board, Chancellor Gonzalez, CEC colleagues, faculty, students, and guests. I can't believe it's been since May that we've reported on the strategic plan to the governing board. That might be because it feels like that's all we do every day right now, but we haven't done it here. So thank you for the opportunity to report the latest accomplishments. Elsa, can we have the next screen, please? Thank you. So in early spring and over the summer, the consultants and chairs engaged the Strategic Planning Steering Committee, CEC members, and the IE Council to generate activities and milestones for the goals. You should be able to see in your board book those activities and milestones that have been identified. The implementation plan includes key performance indicators, and it identifies executive sponsors, project leads, partners, and efforts requiring board, financial, and marketing support. The plan was finalized with support and participation of the colleges. Our college presidents have done a crosswalk of their college strategic plans and priorities with our new system strategic plan goals and activities, and they've engaged their colleges in alignment of those plans. The website is prepared and will go live after our presentation to the governing board once we've made any necessary adjustments that you recommend. Finally, we have a strategic steering team charter and a reporting cadence that will be detailed later in this presentation. Clearly, we've done just a little bit of work since we saw you last. Elsa, next slide, please. But of course, we're not finished. There is work underway to launch and socialize the new strategic plan, and you can see that on the screen. We are looking forward to the soon to be released joint video from our board president and chancellor that will officially launch the plan system wide. You'll see strategic planning chairs soon in a location near you as we visit key stakeholders and colleges to gather support and engagement in the work that we have identified as our shared priorities. And finally, we look forward to working with everyone on what Kathy will share in more detail now.
One comment. I think if I'm looking at your efforts to launch and socialize, that we want to go forward, not backwards.
You're right.
Oh, wow. I love being right.
You are. We will fix that when we
just thought I might throw that out. But
thank you for that.
Oh, you're very welcome.
Appreciate it.
Yeah.
Good evening, President Sullivan. Thank you for that. Members of the board, Kathy Hernandez. I'm Associate Vice Chancellor for Enterprise Performance and Chief of Staff for the Chancellor's Office. As Dr. Newton has shared, we've continued forward progress on strategic plan and associated implementation plan, college crosswalks, reporting and tracking cadence, and steering team development for implementation of what we are calling Excellence 2026, our new strategic plan for Maricopa. The final drafted strategic plan, that is the external facing document, is provided to you in your board book for review, and it is inclusive of activities and milestones. And so I wanted to take a few minutes to maybe talk through a little bit around how those activities were identified, because those are really the core part of the implementation plan that we've developed as sort of our internal operational document. The development of activities and milestones was inclusive of a brainstorming process that took into account current activities and future needs in alignment with the strategic priorities and goals. We developed a comprehensive list, it was quite a lengthy list, that was inclusive of those activities underway and also new and innovative ideas. In some cases, the current activities had strong momentum already happening, but in other cases, we had activities that needed focus and attention towards improvement or opportunities for greater scalability and sustainability. As you can imagine, as we went through this brainstorming and everybody got to feed into what they thought were priority activities, we created a very comprehensive and very long list. And so within that space, we started to think through this list. We began focusing, consolidating, and removing items from that, thinking strategically in relation to the activities that would most positively impact how we serve our students and our community, but also being forward focused, keeping in mind resource constraints that would impact our work over the next 3 years. Each activity in the plan has high-level milestones associated with it. As activity teams begin working in alignment with the strategic plan, there is an intent that they will develop an associated action plan, which will begin to dig in at a deeper level with more detailed milestones. Not only will this inform progress for tracking and reporting purposes, but it will also inform any changes that may be needed in the strategic plan and for high-level milestones as we ensure a fluid process that allows us to move this plan forward, that is data-informed, and that we are making changes as we need to move it forward. The work that we will be doing will be reported through the strategy planning steering team that we'll talk about in just a moment. While we share with you the final plan, I do want to recognize that we do have this deeper implementation plan that will help guide internal operations, provides greater detail that Dr. Newton talked about, responsible parties, key performance indicators, and other aspects that will move this forward. This will become a driving document for that steering team. The other thing we added that you'll see in the strategic plan is a 10-year planning cycle. As we begin moving to an integrated planning model, we've embedded a 10-year system strategic planning cycle. It's our intent to begin putting the system vision and strategy at the forefront of system planning, which will allow colleges to develop plans that support the system plan rather than backing into a plan through retroactive alignment and adjustments. We recognize this will take some time, but conversations in that space are already occurring as some of the colleges begin a new planning cycle. Next slide, please, Elsa. In the planning process, we've heard clearly an interest for more comprehensive tracking and reporting mechanisms, inclusive of a regular reporting cadence to governing board. Therefore, we are proposing quarterly updates to the board that are specific to the strategic priority. For the coming year, we would report on strategy 1 and 2 in October, strategy 3 and 4 in January, and then repeat strategy 1 and 2 in March and close out with June with strategy 3 and 4. In addition to that, we are proposing a mid-year reporting update on all strategic priorities with a final annual progress report provided at year end. The annual progress report would be inclusive of key performance indicator metrics in addition to recommendations for changes that may be needed to the strategic plan and or milestones for the second year. To ensure continuous attention to this work, strategic priority and activity updates would be recurring agenda items for Chancellor's Executive Council, and the strategy planning steering team would be charged with monitoring the planning activities and the outcomes in more detail. From a tracking perspective, we are working with Enterprise Analytics and our Institutional Effectiveness Council on the design of a dashboard that will allow members of the internal community to see progress at the activity level. This would potentially loop back to the aforementioned action plans to align with detailed milestone achievement. And so in some cases, dashboard development and some of those things are still in progress with that enterprise analytics team. We have a mock-up. We don't have anything to share at this point today, but forward progress is being made on that. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to Dr. Daniel, who will talk about next steps with the steering team development.
Good evening, President Sullivan, governing board members, CEC, community members, faculty, and staff. Next slide, Elsa. As you just heard from my two colleagues, there's been a lot of work done since we started this conversation in January with the combination of governing board members as well as CEC members. And as you can see, as we begin to look at the planning stage, we've developed a strategic planning steering committee that's going to integrate the planning models that we've talked about to ensure that our SEM plan, our strategic enrollment management plan, our academic facilities plan, our human resource plan, our technology plans all monitor the ongoing achievements of these plans. I think one of the things that we've talked a lot about is alignment of these plans. That was the first conversation we had back in January, at Gateway, we talked about there's so many things happening. We need to ensure that we align all of these things. And that's going to be the work of the Strategic Planning Steering Committee as we move that forward. Currently, the membership is chaired by the three of us. We will add to that membership. We will have representation from a staff representation, a governing board member, members that we will also look through shared governance to add to the team. We want to make sure that as we develop this team, that it's focused in ensuring that we have the right individuals that will help us monitor at all levels. The intent for us is to continue to look at how we can be successful in ensuring that the steering committee is going to focus and ensure that the planning efforts and the monitoring of this moves forward so that we continue to have forward progress for the entire system and the district. So we look forward to adding new members as we move forward and any input that you'd like to have.
Questions?
That concludes our presentation and questions.
Dr. Gonzalez, do you have any comments before I open it up for some questions?
No, go ahead, Mrs. Sullivan.
Thank you. I do have a couple, and then we'll see where if any of the other board members do as well. I really didn't mean to be sarcastic about the going forward or backwards, so just wanted to draw that forward. Certainly there's a tremendous amount of work that you put into this. I know there is interest from the board to have a representative on your steering committee, and I really appreciate the work that's been done to help define how that role happens for a governing board member when serving on a committee. And that would be part of the protocol for anyone who sits there, but the board hasn't really had a chance to really talk about who that might be and what those protocols are. So as soon as we get to that place, we'll let you know as to who will be there. You know, a couple of things have come up over time, and that is the sense that the strategic plan is interrupting individual college strategic plans. So I'm wondering if you could speak to that overlay and its integration and alignment with those college plans.
Sure. So I think we've had several conversations around the crosswalk. So we have taken individual college crosswalks to the strategic plan and created a system level crosswalk. Each of the colleges have been provided with that information, which allows them to have some autonomy in explaining how the work that they're doing that's built into their strategic plan is aligned with this, and then also identification of gaps. And so each of those individuals have been asked to go back and look through that. I think we have, with 10 colleges, we have colleges that are just launching new plans and are beginning to make some of that alignment. We have some who are starting planning processes, and so it would make sense that this is a natural alignment to look at and align with the current strategic plan. I mean, then we have some that are in mid, and most of the conversations that I've had with college presidents and with the Institutional Effectiveness Council members, who most of whom own the implementation and oversight of strategic plan activities and metrics on their campuses, have explained to me that they do see a space where there is alignment, and we are working with them to create some flexibility in allowing them to help us understand where that space is identified. And then the key gap, I think, that is from a system perspective is 2.1, 2.2, and 3, which we've actually asked the colleges not to align with, because the Chancellor's Executive Council will begin to have collaborative conversations on how we are moving and aligning that as a system rather than 10 individual colleges. So for instance, strategy 3 is around cohesive identity. We don't want 10 different approaches to cohesive identity. So we will be having some of those conversations out of the Chancellor's Executive Council and then within that steering team. My experience has demonstrated that the colleges will be able to align with for some, it might take who are implementing a new plan. It might take them a little bit longer to do some of that. So they are backing into some space. And the council members, i.e. council members, are having to do some of that work. But my team has met with them. Dr. Newton has met with them. We've sort of worked through that i.e. council conversation with them. And I do think we've landed in a place where the colleges feel that they will be able to address alignment and any associated gaps.
Thank you. My other question is tied to, again, your reporting cadence. This will be the first look I think, for majority of board members at which you're recommending. So Dr. Gonzalez, we may want to do a follow-up at some point to see if that is really going to meet the needs of all the board members. I have heard on occasion that at every meeting, there would be an interest to know an issue, but what you're suggesting here is a little different in your reporting model. So perhaps that can be talked about a little differently, not tonight by any means, but certainly as we get more invested in understanding what this means and how that translates into reporting and understanding, because certainly there's an appreciation of all of us to want to be partners in implementing and supporting the plan with our role through policy and other considerations. So that's key for us. My last question then is there a relationship to accreditation cycles and how all of this is being integrated and worked through committees?
Sure. So for the college's accreditation cycle, they get a virtual visit in year 4 and they get a on-site visit in year 10. Each of the colleges has a slightly different cycle. So at the college level, and I can speak to my experience at Gateway, we did have a tiered-year planning cycle that was inclusive of aligning our planning cycle for strategic planning with our HLC process for accreditation, reaffirmation visits, and the association of creating the self-study plans for those. It is my intent at a system level to start to collect all of that for those and build a very comprehensive, within that steering team, a cycle so that we are aware of where each college lands within a 4-year cycle, a 10-year cycle, and then how that impacts the planning. I will go out on a limb and say with 10 colleges, it might be really challenging to try to align some of that because we don't have any control around that year 4 and year 10 cycle. But I do know some of the colleges have their cycle is very close. So we have asked, I have asked for that from our district director of accreditation who tracks those accreditation teams, the visit cycle. And so we will start to embed that as well. But I don't have all that information yet, but it is. Logically, it will help us to make sure that the colleges are not engaging in strategic planning at the same time that they are trying to prepare for self-study visits.
Thank you. Okay, board members, I'm sorry to have occupied that time without engaging your questions. Do you have any comments or questions, board members? Okay, then. So thank you very much for your presentation this evening. Really appreciate it. Thank you, Dr. Gonzalez. Dr. Gonzalez, is there more for your report this evening?
That concludes my report, President Sullivan.
Thank you. And enjoy your visit to DC.
Thank you. And I'll see you in Flagstaff tomorrow.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, that's right. No. All right. So moving on, this is an opportunity for our members of the public to address the governing board. And as we know, in compliance with the open meeting law, the governing board will neither discuss nor take action on any issue raised during this portion of the agenda. Presenting concerns to the board and the free expression of ideas should be communicated with decorum and respect. And as always, we expect good manners and we'll do the same. So with that, I do have one citizen interim speaking request this evening from Ms. Teresa Motes. Is that correct, Ms. Motes, in pronunciation? And please join us at the podium or come to the podium. And you're interested to speak to the students of the South Mountain Community College beach volleyball and the cancellation of the program. Is that correct? And you have 3 minutes to present to us. Thank you. You're welcome. Ms. Motes, is there a button you could press? Thank you so much.
I'm just at a loss at how disappointed I am as a parent of a 4.0 student who received an email on July 10th that this program was canceled, giving my student, as well as the other 11 students on this team, a very short time to readjust, find a new place to go if they wanted to continue doing what they love, which is being a student athlete. And this group had fundraised $18,000 And we're looking to seek where is this money now going to go? Because they worked really hard thinking there would be at least one more year. My daughter loves South Mountain Community College, absolutely loves the culture, the atmosphere, the teachers, and she's really struggled to try to find where do I go next and where am I going to get the best with what you were offering. Her bachelor's program that she was hoping to continue with you is not offered at the other options. And she's just beside herself. There were 11 on this team that were full beach athletes and a coach who I thought was outstanding. And I would tell you that many of the girls felt the same way. They went from this last season with only having one other competitor in town that was in their division, but ended up being able to come in with an at-large bid due to other wins. And they traveled to Florida, at which time they finished from the bottom to number four and were the only out-of-state team to finish in the top four because the rest were all taken by Florida. I'm at a loss as to what keeps happening to our athletic programs in our community colleges. I would like to see that all of Arizona has an opportunity to be able to still compete after putting so much effort in. And I thank you for your time. I hope that you'll continue to consider not cutting these amazing programs. Thank you.
Thank you for your time this evening.
With that, I'm going to move to the consideration of the consent agenda items, and all items under the section of the agenda are consent matters unless they are removed from the consent agenda at this time. I want to remind board members that when we went through agenda review, 2 weeks ago now, there was a discussion on several of the items presented in the consent agenda. We did ask for follow-up. I believe we received follow-up on everything. With that, board members, I'm going to ask, is there any item on the consent agenda that you wish to be pulled for action or further discussion? Thank you, Ms. Ellis, for getting us the answers to the questions. So given that there's no one or the chancellor who wished to remove any items from the agenda, is there a motion to approve the consent agenda? Thank you, Ms. Bittersmith. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Davis. So all those in favor, please vote by saying aye, and I would include you, Mr. Burnett, in that.
Aye.
Any opposed? Being none, by a vote of 7-0 with our student advisory vote, the consent agenda has been approved. Thank you, everyone. So now we're moving to non-consent action item, our second read and adoption of governing board policy changes to 3.3 delegation to chancellor and 4.4 board planning and agenda preparation. Is there a motion to approve the board policies 3.3 and 4.4 as presented? And Dr. Thor, given your work on that, would you like to lead with that motion?
So move. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Thor. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Dr. Nerini. Is there any discussion on the motion? Being none, all those in favor, and again, Mr. Burnett, I'm going to like to include you in this. All those in favor, please vote by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Being none, by a vote of 7-0 with our student advisory vote included, the listed policy and amendments are adopted. Thank you again, Dr. Thor, for your leadership on all of that. Moving again then, we now have a first read of governing board policy changes to 4.9 board committee structure. We reviewed that in an agenda review, but are there any comments or questions on this first read? Thank you. Being none, we'll look forward to the second read and vote on that our next meeting. We now move to employment and separations, May 13, 23 through July 14, 23. Board members, do you have any comments or questions? Being none, we'll move on to the monitoring reports. Budget analysis report, Fund 1, general unrestricted fund for the 12 months ending 6/30/2023. Board members, are there any comments or questions? Being none, we'll now move to budget analysis report, Fund 1, general unrestricted fund for the 1 month ending July 31st, 2023. Board members, are there any comments or questions? Being none, now we're going to move to community reports, and I'll start with you, Mr. Burnett. Do you have any report for us this evening?
Just a couple items. I had the opportunity to do a filming with Mel Valenzuela to film an informative support video for the DEI climate survey. It's pretty interesting. Did it all very, very quickly. Only took about 35 takes to get it right. But it was enjoyable. Hopefully it'll come out. And I'm not on the level of Dr. Peterson, but I'm working to get there. And then on the 18th, I was invited to speak to the brand new Senate, and that was very enjoyable. There's an entire new crew of very, very excited young people who hit the ground at the beginning of the year, already wanting to make a difference, wanting to start committees, wanting to chair committees. As I listened as much as I spoke, there were you can see the buzz in this. I think you're going to have a lot more of these young people attending governing board meetings because they want to grow, they want to learn, and they want to make an impact. They want to make a difference. They don't want to just get an education. One of the questions that I challenged them with was to, make sure that, you find your cause while you're here for 2, 3, 4 years, however long you plan on being here. Make sure you find your cause and make sure you find your takeaway. Because you're devoting 2 or 4 years of your life to an institution of learning, higher learning, and you want to make sure you walk away from this with more than just a certificate or a degree. And, they instantly, one of the senators, I can't remember which one it was, instantly shot back, "What was your takeaway?" And I didn't have to hesitate. I said, "You people have renewed my faith in the younger generation. I had almost lost faith in watching my kids just kind of squander and do nothing." And I sort of attributed that to a lot of the generation. And then I get around the students at the school at the different colleges, and I see there are young people that truly do want to make an impact, they see themselves sitting where you all are sitting in positions that you all have. And that's good. That renews my faith in the generation. It was what I needed. So that was a blessing to be in that initial meeting with the brand new senators. And yesterday we did the pre-runway to success reception. For Gateway Community College and Dr. Amy Diaz, she asked me, she goes, "Did you know anybody there?" I said, "I knew you." I was glad to walk in there. I saw Dr. Narini and President Sullivan were there, and it was very, very enjoyable. They were gracious enough to introduce me to a bunch of people that I didn't know that I got to know. And I think it's going to be a fantastic. I didn't get to attend last year, but I can tell you that based on what was in that room and the excitement, the fact that there were people that really, really, truly wanted to be there and people didn't want to leave, that I think you're going to have a fantastic ceremony, a fantastic runway celebration, a great fundraiser. Should be awesome. I'm looking forward to it. And then finally, first day of school, I had to drop physics. We tend to, as go-getters, and all of you are, you wouldn't be in the position you're in if you weren't go-getters, overachievers. We sometimes tend to bite off more than we can chew. And I, think in 18 semester hours, I did 23 or 24 semester hours when I was at the academy, and it was no big deal. That was what everybody did. And I'm doing 18 here, and I started thinking, wait a minute. I sat in the first day of physics class, and I go, "I can't do this. What am I thinking?" So I put it off for another semester, but the one good thing, I mean, there were more than one good thing, but one thing I did notice when I was on the CGCC campus this morning, which again, just renewed my faith and lifted my heart, lifted my spirits, was I saw a plethora of faculty and staff running around, guiding people to their classes. I mean, you know, there were kids walking on campus for the first time out of high school. I'm like, well, where do I go? And they go, what class are you taking? And go, oh, it's right over there. Go right through that door and turn to the right. And it's a small thing, but when you see grown adults helping kids, helping young adults, I should say, I apologize, helping young adults just find the way to class on the first day, kind of makes you know you're in the right place, doing the right thing. So that's my report, President Sullivan.
Thank you, Ms. Renette. Ms. Smith.
Sure, I'll offer a few reflections. Today, I attended a transfer student reception that was held at ASU, and I just want to thank folks in the Maricopa Community Colleges for help getting the word out. There were sessions held at all of the campuses, so I was on the Tempe campus today. So I made it a point to go up to folks that were wearing a name tag that says the state where they transferred from was Arizona. So I talked with students today from CGCC and MCC, and so far so good. They said the transition has been really smooth, but every student that I talked to said that housing is very expensive. And it is, I was asking, is there anything that's stressing you? How are you feeling about this semester? What's on your mind? And I just wanted to relay that I'm reflecting on these demands on our students' times and the stress that it causes for them. And one student who even said that she pays so much for rent, but her Wi-Fi in her apartment building went out on the second day of school. So she was standing outside in the rain trying to catch a Wi-Fi signal and trying to get on the internet. And so I just want to commend students who have transferred or students who are about to transfer that, you know, we're thinking of you and thinking of ways that we can try to raise supportive resources to support students and the expenses that they face and the unexpected experiences they may have, such as no Wi-Fi when you're trying to submit your first homework assignment. That concludes my report. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Smith. Ms. Butler.
Thank you very much. I noticed that Chancellor Gonzalez highlighted some TV news coverage, I think, of some of our colleges, but I wanted to mention and flag for you that AZ Central had a great article about GCC and Dr. Hernandez and their cybersecurity program that is now being able to partner students with rural communities to monitor their cyber activity and make sure that they are staying safe. Free for the municipalities, which is a huge help for them, I'm sure. Wonderful program at GCC, and we're just proud to talk about that too. Oh, and I wanted to thank the AZ Central reporter, Sasha Hupka, who I had not met as a higher ed reporter, but you know, anytime that they're highlighting our outstanding programs in the news or at written reports or anything, we need to appreciate that because it is just so, it just makes us all so proud of all these wonderful programs that we have. Thanks.
Thank you. Dr. Nerini.
Yes, speaking of that, I was at Glendale's ribbon cutting and increased my wardrobe for the cybersecurity program. So I did that on the 18th. On the 15th, I attended PC's convocation, which was a lot of fun to see all the stats and data that they had. And then afterwards, I was able to tour the MESA program that they had, which is remarkable what they're doing with some of the students and the things that are going on. And then again, last night with Ms. Sullivan and Ms. Burnett, I was at the pre-runway event. So I'm really looking forward to that. That was exciting. It was a lot of fun people to meet and chat with. So yes, thank you. And that concludes my report.
Thank you, Dr. Thor.
I do not have a report tonight, but I do want to join with the others in welcoming our faculty, staff, and students, whether they're returning or new. And we also are very excited about the fall semester with the new bachelor's degree programs and the increasing enrollment. So thanks to everybody who made that happen.
Thank you, Dr. Thor. Ms. Davis.
I don't have much of a report either. I got to meet Dr. Hernandez at a social event. It wasn't anything to do with the college, but I at least got to meet her. So I was grateful to get to meet her that night. And then relative to the student life reports, my grandson started community college in Southern California yesterday. And I hope that he has student life and senators like you guys to lead him into this new journey that he's taking, because he's going to need all the help he can probably get.
Sounds like my kids.
Thank you, Ms. Davis. Ms. Bittersmith.
Thank you, President Sullivan. I just wanted to acknowledge a few life events that have happened too in the Community College District, starting with our intrepid leader of the Communications Department, Mr. Coolidge, who's sitting in the back, who is the father of a brand new baby boy. So congratulations to him. Something is happening in his team, though, because yet today, Tommy McCone, who works as part of his team, also added another baby boy to his family as well. And there's one more to come. So I'm not quite sure what's happening in your office, but when she delivers, we will acknowledge that too.
Not you, I didn't mean you, but you have.
That's true, but I am finally, after 3 years, 2.5 years almost, of this board hearing my complaint about not being a grandmother, I'm delighted to tell you my son has finally met his mark, and I will be having a grandchild at some point in March. So. It's taken a long time. You don't know the saga, but and then there is one sad thing I wanted to note, which is that former State Representative Bill McCune, who also was a PBS documentary contributor, but importantly for this community, was a past president of the Phoenix College, student body president at Phoenix College, and then very active in the Phoenix College Alumni Association, mm-hmm. passed away yesterday. I met Bill really as a young legislator, and I was a very young lobbyist. But even at that point, he was talking about the community colleges, always very, very active in supporting and engaging and making sure the district was strong. To my knowledge, there is no service plan, but I just wanted to acknowledge his contribution to the district. And with that, that's my report.
Thank you very much, Ms. Bittersmith. So back to me, you've heard where I've been and where I'm going. That would be the runway event. Thank you, Dr. Diaz, for hosting us last evening, and to the retreat with AC4 and AACCT. And one of our agenda items is going to be talking how can we address on the state level some legislative activity that we all want to invest in. And Dr. Gonzalez and I have been supported by the Government Relations Office in helping us understand what our potential interests are in that area. That will be coming to the board in a more defined form, I believe, next month. And I don't know if Ms. Moore is going to bring her new child with her when she makes that report, or if she's going to pass the torch to someone else for that, but look forward to that. And we'll certainly provide you a report with where that goes in the EC4 AACCT meeting. Board members, I want to say that as we're looking at the beginning of a new academic year, we're also looking at toward the conclusion of a calendar year. And with that, I expect that we will want to have one more retreat. So stay tuned for some potential dates around that. And our challenge there is going to be something a bit different. We've done some self-evaluations before, but I'm going to put that back on the table for us to evaluate ourselves as a governing board collectively, and also to ask us to examine our own contributions as individual board members. So be thinking about how you might want to respond to those questions, because we know that we only learn and grow if we pay attention to our plus and minuses or our challenges. And who knows, we may turn that into a 360, just putting it out there to all of you who might be part of some 360, not at this table. So just wanting you to be aware of that. The other piece, as we think through our future as a governing board in these closing calendar year months, has been that we've done a lot of work on board policies, again, thanks to your leadership, Dr. Thor's chair of that committee of one. but with that, you know, one of the things that we supported or voted on this evening was our new framework around committees. There is some work that's been done with Dr. Jenna's help, Dr. Lashinsky's help, Mr. Champel, Dr. Nerini and me, that have thought through what does board participation on committees look like. we know sometimes that if you hear the words that a board member has an interest in being on a committee, all of a sudden the hair on the nape of the neck kind of stands up and people start to panic and think, oh my God, are they really going to tell us what to do? No, we aren't. What we do, however, is believe that we have a role to play in the shared governance model to make our contributions to a thoughtful agenda and purpose to the work that we all do together, and then reflect back on our role as policymakers, people who support budgets, to think through how can we either enhance or move a project forward, support the redesign based on those two thoughts. So as we're looking forward to laying out that protocol, we'll be thinking about where are and there are opportunities for board members to make contributions in those arenas. So stay tuned, board members, because we'll be talking about where your future roles might apply in certain areas of interest. And to all of you leaders out there who are in our audience and are listening, no, we're not, we want to be partners in a more thoughtful, collaborative way than even we might have been in the past. Because as we said earlier this evening to the students, we're all about the students, how we can do a better job, how we can ensure that arts and music programs don't go away, Dr. Hunter, and how we can prevail in legislature, in Congress, how we can ensure that our chancellor is top of mind when it comes to convening people with an interest of workforce development, particularly in the manufacturing arena, and being able to say, are you kidding? You're not going to the White House? What? So of course you will. Anyway, that's long-winded, but I did want to set out a bit of an agenda for us as we think through our few months together again as we close out this calendar year and anticipate the leadership this year of the academic year. So on behalf of the governing board, it's a delight to see all of you, to hear your reports. We look forward to more. We look forward to doing our work, to staying professionals in that space with you. And Dr. Gonzalez, we know that you have a great team to work with, has your back, has our back. We have yours, we have all of yours. So let's get moving and get into this academic year. Congratulations, everyone, on a good start. Good night. I adjourn the meeting.